And please join me in prayer. O God, from the rising of the sun to its setting, your name is worthy of all praise. Let our prayer rise before you as incense, and with the lifting up of our hands, may we offer our whole lives to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And if you're able, I invite you to stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The reading is from St. Mark, the 6th chapter. Mark writes, Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joses, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And Jesus was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. And he said to them, Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, as we gather for worship at this hour in Spokane, Washington, Pastor John Guthridge is gathering for worship for his ordination. Right at this same time. So, being we can't be there and here at the same time, I thought maybe we could begin our service, or at least my sermon, with a prayer that's actually used in the ordination service. I know some of you have been to ordination services, and they are powerful, powerful services. But let's pray together this prayer that's actually used in the ordination service as we join in spirit with their worship in Spokane, Washington. So let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise, we pray. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, we bless you for your infinite love in Christ our Lord, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. And we thank you that by his death your Son has overcome death, and having been raised by your mighty power, he ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. We praise you that Christ has poured out his gifts abundantly on the church, making some apostles, some prophets, some pastors and teachers, to equip your people for their work of ministry and for building up the body of Christ. Eternal God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Pastor John Guthridge and fill him with the gifts of your grace for the ministry of word and sacrament. Bless his proclamation of your word and administration of your sacraments, O Lord, so that your church may be gathered for praise and strengthened for service. Make him a faithful pastor, a patient teacher, a wise counselor. Grant that in all things he may serve without reproach, that your people may be renewed and your name be glorified in the church. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for that. Maybe we'll send him a tape of your prayer. Well, it's summer, and most of us spend at least some time during the summer at a family reunion, right? Or maybe at least a class reunion. And I was thinking about this as my class of Lake Benton High School will have its 30th. Can you imagine that? 30th reunion this summer. Now, when we go to family reunions, when you go to family reunions, class reunions, some of us have a great time at those events, and others, not so great of a time, right? That's the way it is. That's just the way it is with family reunions. That's the way it is with class reunions. So Mark begins his sixth chapter by telling us that Jesus returned to his hometown of Nazareth, where he was around those who watched him grow up. And Mark even provides the names of his brothers and sisters. And Mark makes it clear that Jesus did not have a good time in his hometown reunion, because the people of Nazareth thought that they knew him too well to believe that he could actually be the Messiah. In fact, we're told that Jesus was amazed at their unbelief. That's what Mark says. Jesus was amazed at their unbelief in him. So it is in this context that we come to our text today, which immediately follows Jesus' bad experience in his hometown of Nazareth. So we're told at the beginning, he called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, because the disciples, Mark tells us, follow Jesus to his hometown. And Jesus gave them authority over the unclean spirits. So Jesus is commissioning his followers to take on the evil spirits. Maybe mostly the evil spirits that were found right there in his hometown of Nazareth. But Jesus tells his followers to take on these evil spirits. And that is a commission that falls to all of Jesus' followers. It falls on to all of us as well, to take on the evil spirits. It falls on to you as a follower of Jesus to take on these evil spirits. Now, we may not be so comfortable with the language of these evil spirits or unclean spirits. We might not be so comfortable even with the language of evil. But surely we can all agree that something is wrong in the world. Certainly we can all agree that there is evil and unclean spirits that are at work in the world. We have read so much about suicide bombers in Iraq and in Afghanistan and in the Middle East, and we've heard so much about frequent shootings, be it on the streets of Ferguson, Missouri, or even in sacred places like that of churches in Charleston, South Carolina. And we have encountered so many disturbing stories that it's easy for us to just kind of get used to hearing these stories on the news. And getting used to any of this is evil in itself. We should never get used to hearing these stories. But apart from that, let us also remember tonight that there are plenty of problems right here in our own little Nazareth. There are plenty of problems right here in our own little town. For in beautiful homes all over our village, families are struggling to keep it all together. The parents work in places that are plagued by unclean spirits of meanness or competitiveness, and their children know about the unclean spirit of mean peer pressure, or maybe even bullying. So in the course of a day, we get so much of that meanness all over us that we can't help but bring some of it home when we return there to that place. So in a way, if you think about it, we have our own version of the man who enters the sanctity of a church home and destroys everyone there. Because we do it every day, in a way. So today we learn that we, as Christ's disciples, have been given the authority to participate in a holy mission. And we have the calling to stand up and say, we do not have to live like this. We don't have to live in this meanness anymore. So all we have to do is to use this hope, to use this peace, to use this joy, to use this love that Jesus, the Savior, the Messiah, has been teaching us all about. To cast out whatever is evil in our world, or whatever is hurtful in our world, or even in our lives. So Jesus cares about this. Jesus really cares about this. Jesus cares about what we are doing to combat evil spirits in the world. And he cares that you're doing something to combat that as well. So how will you do that? How will you find the courage to do that? How will you find the courage to take on the unclean spirits that lurk in the souls of men and women, causing them to hurt themselves and hurt others, and possibly even self-destruct? How are you going to do that? Well, this is where it gets really interesting. Next verse. Verse 8, Jesus ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and to not put on two tunics. So if Jesus is giving his disciples and giving you and me such an overwhelming mission as casting out evil spirits, you would have thought that Jesus would have sent them and would have sent us out better equipped. Jesus says you need to trim down, right? You need to trim down. Clearly, Jesus does not expect us to give up our homes or our food or to wear only sandals, though it's kind of fun to wear sandals in the summertime, right? Is Jesus serious about this? Jesus just expects us not to cling to anything that we are holding. That's what Jesus expects. He expects us to stay on the move through life, growing in faith, always growing in faith. Remember the saying, if you're not dead, then you're not done, right? If you're not dead, then you're not done. Say that. If you're not dead, then you're not done. Turn to the person next to you and say that. If you're not dead, then you're not done. Right? Hopefully the person next to you doesn't look dead. If you're not dead, then you're not done. Jesus wants us to keep moving, doesn't he? Jesus always wants us to be moving in him. If we're not dead, then we're not done. And Jesus is not done with you. Jesus is calling you to cast out evil, even the evil in your own heart. Or at least listen to the voice of the Savior who can cast out that evil within you. At least that. At the very least, listen to the voice of the Savior who will cast that out. And Jesus expects us to travel lightly. One reason for the call to travel lightly is if you're going to participate in Jesus' mission of bringing this world back home to God, you cannot be afraid of what you have to lose. This weekend, we will pause with the rest of the country to give thanks for our independence. It was an incredible dream that our forefathers and even our foremothers left to us with the signing of the Declaration of Independence. And it is a great dream that took on the evils of greed and corruption that had infiltrated into the colonies, right? That's why America wanted its independence. But let us remember that one of the things that made those earliest colonists heroes is that they knew what their freedom would cost them. And they were willing to pay that. They were willing to pay the cost. And so it is for you, and so it is for me. You can either keep hold of the way it is today, or you can use your life to hold a great dream. But you can't hold both things. You can't hold on to both things. If you want a dream worthy of your life, you will more than likely have to let go of something. That's why Jesus gives us these words. We are never going to go far if we're weighed down by baggage. And I don't know if you've ever stood for a long time at a baggage carousel at the airport. Have you ever done that before? It's proof to me that all people are inherently spiritual because everyone gathered there is in prayer, right? They're praying that their luggage is going to come off onto that carousel. Meanwhile, the people who have chosen to travel lightly, they're on their way out the door, aren't they? They're already gone. The heaviest baggage we carry around is not our many possessions, but I think it's probably our emotional baggage. Down the chute comes the baggage of broken relationships, or disappointments, or guilt over what we've done or left undone. Then down tumbles the baggage of hurts from our childhood. And that is the big ugly suitcase that just keeps going around in circles because no one wants to pick that one up. And then there is also the heavy baggage of our expectations, which is just a veiled attempt at controlling the future, which none of us really can do. And some of the heaviest expectations that we have are for our children, right? Those are our heaviest expectations. But as our text today makes clear, Jesus is not the airport attendant who's going to lug this baggage around for you. Look at this picture. I love this picture that's coming up. Jesus isn't going to lug that around for you. And Jesus doesn't want you to lug that around. So he gives us these words for today. He wants you to walk away from this baggage. He wants you to travel lightly. And Jesus wants you to be free of the baggage of society that society tries to lay upon you. Free of the fears of what you will inevitably lose. Free of the possessions that have taken possession of you. And free of the guilt that really has sucked your humanity away from you. So Jesus calls you to himself, not to keep you afraid of a world plagued with evil and unclean spirits, but by following him, to learn how to be free in the world, but not of the world. Did you hear that? To be free in the world, but not of the world. So Jesus' dream is to free you to be who God created you to be, and who God is leading you back to being again.